Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our talk for improving service availability, scaling ahead with machine learning for HP optimization. My name is Avni Sharma. I'm product manager at Intuit Kubernetes Service. And with me, I have Estela, who's engineer at IKS as well. So let's look at our agenda for today. We'll be covering a little bit about Intuit, and then the problem statements that come up as we work at scale, and then our proposed solution, demo learnings, and Q&A. So for those of you who don't know about Intuit, Intuit is a global fintech company that builds several financial products and services based on an AI-driven expert platform. And if you've used TurboTax for tax prep or QuickBooks for accounting and payroll, know that you're running on an AI-native driven platform and our Kubernetes-based platform infra. And this development platform serves 100 million customers across our various brands, including TurboTax, Credit Karma, QuickBooks, and MailChimp. We are big users of open source tooling and have a commitment of giving back to the community. And I wanted to cover a little bit more about our platform and our AI-native development platform and the scale at which it runs. We are able to support over 4 million models running in production per day, which has helped us in unlocking around 8x developer velocity over the past 4 years. We are also able to power 60 billion machine learning predictions and 40 million AIOps inferences per day. And our platform is built of these key 4 pillars. And as part of today's talk, we would be covering the 3rd one, which is the AI-powered app-centric runtime. And as part of that, we have an autoscaling platform that offloads a lot of those autoscaling decisions from our service developers. So let's look at the problem statements and the challenges that come when we run at such a scale. So the first one is around that application plus Kubernetes cannot scale up fast enough. So let's say we take an app that has high traffic. It will have the following scenario. HPA detects higher load and triggers scale up, and then the scheduler tries to schedule new pods on existing nodes. And when this is happening, HPA cannot scale fast enough because there can be times when there is a high pod startup time. So what is a pod startup time? Pod startup time is the time it takes for pod to transition from scheduled to a ready state. And pod needs this amount of time to become ready to serve traffic. And there can be a lot of parameters leading to this high pod startup time, which can be image pulling or node allocation time, DB connection, or certain application-specific scenarios or slow app startup time for Java apps. And in several incidents at Intuit, we have seen that a service can also have a startup time more than 10 minutes. And why is this an issue? It's an issue because this can result in 5xx errors and pods can't handle incoming traffic. The second problem that can happen is that development teams have difficulty in right-sizing the app. So what they do is they do over-provision their apps. And they over-provision this because they are anticipating increase in traffic on certain day or time. And they want to be confident that their app will be able to handle the traffic well in advance. So they often set up 2 conservative min replicas for HPA to withhold resources. And over-provisioning is an issue because it leads to a high cost. And even if the consumption is not there, the resources are being used because HPA will look into the min replica and those spots would be allocated already. So let's look at our proposed solution. Our proposed solution is to use a time series forecasting model to predict the upcoming CPU usage pattern and let HPA kick in earlier. And this model will predict the CPU usage for the next X amount of minutes in real time, giving new pods that amount of time to become ready before they are needed and before the traffic is served. This predicted CPU usage will be a metric that can be exposed to Prometheus, And that way, HPA can fetch this metric and proactively scale based on this predicted metric ahead of time. And in our demo, we will be training the model to predict X amount of minutes before, but this time is actually the calculated pod startup time for each service, so it will vary service to service. And the reason we scale on CPU usage is because 80% of our services scale based on CPU metrics. Some of the benefits, it will help in improving service availability. So new pod will come up before it is actually needed and reduce as well as eliminate 5xx errors, which you would incur due to a high pod startup time. Second one is that it's beneficial for apps with weekly traffic pattern, and the model will be able to predict future pattern, and therefore app can scale up ahead of time. And now application teams do not need to find optimal values for min replica. We as platform team would be setting the right value for them, and this would result in reduced resource wastage and therefore better cost saving. So let's look at our architecture at a glance and what does our autoscaling solution entails. So there are two parts to our autoscaling solution. One is the real time, and then we have the long-term recommendation system. So when I see the recommendation part on the top left corner, there are three recommenders as part of that. One is the pod size recommender, which is around the vertical sizing of the pod. Then we have the HPA target metric recommender. So at Intuit, we not only suggest min and max replicas for our deployments, but we also look at into the right metric to scale on. So there can be several metrics like thread pool count or TPS and so on and so forth. So the solution would also look into the right metric to scale on. And then obviously we have the replica recommender for horizontal scaling. And then there are additional components as part of our long-term engine here, which is this app startup time aggregator and the ML model trainer, which Estela would be covering in our demo in a few more minutes. So the real-time metrics is running in the cluster. Global updater will look into all the metrics and come to a solution for size of the pod and the replica count. And as and when the recommendation is generated, we populate it in an S3 bucket. And this recommendation is in the form of a YAML for every service. The converter that we see here then converts that simple manifest to Kubernetes runtime manifest. And at the same time, the global updater will also trigger the application deployment pipeline. And then Argo CD applies changes to our actual running cluster. And in the meantime, whenever any recommendation changes, it triggers an event, and that is sent to Kafka. And that event will call the global updater to reanalyze the metrics and populate the recommendation. So all the green boxes that you see here are Intuit components, and the blue ones are the open source components. Now let's look into our horizontal scaling solution, which comprises of the replica recommender and HPA recommender. So the horizontal scaling at Intuit, we have it in two parts. One is the real-time recommendation, and then the long-term recommendation. So we have implemented a new in-cluster controller called the HPA recommender, and this real-time recommendation updates HPA max replicas if the current load is very high and the desired replica count already reaches 90% of the existing max replica count. And we want it to be real time because we want to be able to scale when these thresholds are reaching. And then the long term is looking at the historical data, which is about 1 week's old worth of data. And the long term would generate new HPA min max replicas recommendation based on pod size recommender target CPU memory recommendation. And just wanted to also point out how these recommendations show up on our development portal. So we, as platform teams, we take these decisions on behalf of the users, but in a lot of user interviews, we found that they really wanted to know what kind of operation is being applied in the backend. So we have this read-only view for our users to have that visibility into the system. The operation shows the type of change that has been applied, which is around pod size change or HPA changes. And if they click on the details, they would be able to see the exact diff that was applied by the autoscaling recommendation system. These two are snippets of our recommendations. Above is the manifest that is stored in an S3 bucket. And the below one is the deployment repo that is there with every service. The IKS Express log file is where it syncs to the S3 whenever there is a change. So then this IKS Express log is actually read and applied in the cluster. I also wanted to show a graph snippet over here. So the autoscaling as we have implemented at Intuit is largely conservative with a bias towards operational availability and correctness. So as and when autoscale engine begins to adapt to traffic that the service is receiving, we only slowly bump down the HPA, only about 10% each time, and that lets us optimize for availability as well. Now I would like to pass it on to Estela to go over app startup time and ML model training.
Thank you, Avni. So our solution has two main components. One is running outside of the cluster for model training, and one is running inside of the cluster for real-time metric prediction and scaling. Outside of the cluster, we have the app startup time aggregator and the model trainer. The aggregator will calculate the pod startup time for each service and then push that metric to Wavefront. And the model trainer will collect the CPU metrics data for the past 7 days, and it'll use that data to train the model. And once the model is trained, it'll push it to S3. And for every service that wants to use the solution, we need to train a separate model and push it to S3 as well. And inside the cluster, we have a couple of controllers running. So we have the real-time predictor, which will fetch the pod startup time. And it'll also load all the models from S3, and it'll fetch the real-time CPU metrics from Prometheus. And it'll feed those metrics to the pre-trained model, so then it can generate the prediction metric. And now it can expose that prediction metric back to Prometheus. And once we have this new metric, we can add it to the HPA spec, so now that the controller can scale on this new metric. And another controller we have running in cluster is the HPA recommender, which works similarly to the native Kubernetes HPA. So to recap the workflow, we first calculate the pod startup time. Then we want to train the model with 7 days worth of data. Then we upload the model to S3. And inside the cluster, we're going to fetch the pod startup time, the model, and the real-time CPU metrics to generate a new predictive metric. And finally, we add that metric to HPA. And so to find the model that best fit our use case, we looked at 4 separate time series forecasting models. We looked at the profit model, the times FM model, a GRU-based model that was built into it, and an enhanced forecasting model. So the way the profit model works, it'll add different components like yearly, weekly, and daily patterns, and also holiday effects to predict future trends. And it works well with data that has strong seasonal patterns and has several seasons worth of data. And so this is the result we got when we tried it out. And so here, the blue line is the real CPU usage, and the red line is the predictive metric. And here, the outside gray lines are the upper and lower bounds, which represent the model's levels of uncertainty. So at first, the model is able to predict ahead of time when the usage is increasing and decreasing, but over time, this prediction is too far off. And also, in the beginning, the intervals do capture the real CPU usage, but over time, these intervals grow even wider, which means that the model is losing certainty in its ability to predict. The next model we looked at was the Google's TimeFM model, and this is a pre-trained model, and it can use both static and dynamic data to make better predictions, and it's a decoder-only architecture. So this is what we got when we use this model, and it gives us a range of possible outcomes. It'll give us a 10th, 50th, and 90th percentile predictions. And here, the 90th percentile prediction is a red line. And what it means is that there's a 90% chance that the actual CPU usage will be below this line. And here, the green line is the validation line, which is our real CPU usage. And so half the time, you see the green line is above the 90th percentile, which means that the model is underestimating the CPU usage. The third model we looked at is an in-house GRU-based forecasting model in NumaLogic, and it's a sequence-to-sequence architecture, and it's capable of forecasting multiple variables at the same time, and it'll generate these distribution intervals for us. So this is what we got when we used this model, and although the confidence intervals do capture the CPU usage, here the blue line is the real usage and the orange line is the prediction metric. The prediction metric isn't able to grow or decrease before the usage increases or decreases. So it's not really growing ahead of time. And the last model we looked at is the inheats model from the Python library. And this is a neural network model. So it'll look at the previous connections in the network to process past data, and it'll look at forward connections to generate future predictions. And here, the green line is the real usage, and the red line is the usage prediction. And so here, the prediction is ahead of the real usage, which means that the model is actually able to predict the pattern ahead of time. So in our solution, we use the inheats model. And so for our demo, we'll show you what the prediction looks like when you look at it locally using the inheats model, and we'll kind of give you an overview of how to implement the solution. So, how to play? Okay.
Here.
Can I play it though?
It's working.
Oh, is it?
Mm-hmm.
Is it playing?
Yeah.
Okay, so here the blue line is the actual usage, and the red line is the prediction metric. And so here locally, we trained it to predict 20 minutes ahead of time. So if we zoom in, we'll be able to see how ahead of time it's actually predicting. So at this time, I believe it's 12:30, it's saying that the real usage will hit 70,000 millicores. And you can see that the usage does hit that number about 19 to 20 minutes later. So it is predicting ahead of time. And then we're gonna look at a separate point to verify how ahead of time it's predicting. Yeah, so we'll look at another point, and here, the prediction is saying that it'll hit 41,200 millicores, and it does hit that value around 15 minutes later. So on average, it's predicting 15 to 20 minutes ahead of time. And then we're gonna look at how ahead of time it's predicting when the usage is decreasing. So what we saw when it's decreasing, it's predicting around 10 minutes ahead of time, so not as far ahead of time as when it's increasing. So here, it's predicting 70,000 millicores, and it hits that value around 10 to 11 minutes later. And then sometimes you'll see that the prediction metric will be falling behind the real usage. And that's okay, because the way HPA works, it'll look at all the metrics in the spec. So we have our original CPU metric, and then we have this predicted metric. If the prediction is falling behind, it'll scale based on the real CPU metric. So it'll bring up pods when necessary. And it's also important to note that if the prediction is scaling, or it's decreasing ahead of the real usage, HPA won't decrease the number of replicas based on the predicted metric, because again, in that case, the real metric will have a higher value, and so HPA will calculate the desired replicas based on the real CPU metric. Okay, so now that we've trained it and generated this prediction metric, we want to be able to expose it. So internally, we generated this metric for several services. And here, we're showing that we exposed it. The red line is a prediction, and the blue line is a real usage. So it's ahead of time, which is what we want. And now that we've exposed the metric to Prometheus, we want to be able to have HPA use it so it can scale on it. So this is simple to do because the existing Kubernetes HPA already allows you to use custom metrics. So all you have to do is just add this new metric to your HPA. And we also want to set the target value as the same as your original metric, because you still want to start scaling when you hit this threshold. In this case, you're just going to hit that threshold and start scaling a little bit sooner. And so we learned a lot and ran into a couple of issues working on this, and I'm going to go over those. So the first learning we had was during our performance test. So we wanted to test how well this new metric could perform in a test scenario. So we gave the model 7 days worth of simulated data that had a clear weekly pattern. And what we saw was that the model was having a hard time recognizing the usage pattern during the first 10 minutes. It was having a hard time recognizing the first time the usage really increased or decreased. And that's because our scale-up window that we were giving our tests was 30 minutes, which was too short of a window for our model to really learn the pattern. And so once we bumped up this window to 60 minutes, we saw better results. And the second issue we faced was that the model isn't able to predict an abnormal spike in CPU. And also, if our input data was too spiky, our output prediction would be spiky as well. And so something that helped us there was just smoothing our input data, and that smoothed out our prediction. And the last issue we faced was just not having enough data, and so that's why some of the models probably didn't work for us. The more data we could have, the better results we get. And so in the future, we'd like to enhance our solution. So currently, we're generating this metric for apps that have a weekly traffic pattern, but we'd like to extend it to apps that have a seasonal traffic pattern. So for example, apps that get their most CPU usage during tax peak or a Super Bowl event, we'd like to generate the metric for those as well. And besides generating a metric to predict CPU usage, we'd also like to do it for other metrics, because not all of our customers scale based on CPU metrics. So we could also do it for TPS, custom metrics, or JVM related metrics. And lastly, this new predicted metric can influence the real CPU pattern. And so to avoid that, instead of generating a metric based on just CPU usage alone or just one metric alone, we'd like to generate a prediction metric based on a combination of other metrics. That way we can scale ahead of time without influencing the real data.
Cool. Thanks, Estela, for a great demo. So just wanted to mention that here at Intuit, we believe in open source and open collaboration. We've been recipient of the End User Award for 2019 and 22, and we also actively participate in open source contributions. We've created an open source several projects. One of the famous ones is Arco. And just wanted to say that that you can follow our Intuit open source journey and stay in the loop for other interesting advancements. And this QR code, just feel free to scan that. Also, you can check out our past presentations on our abstracted platform, autoscaling and debuggability in these links. These are some of those past KubeCon presentations, and thank you for joining us today for this session.
Thank you.
Yeah, we are now up for Q&A.
Hello, thank you for the great talk. I'm curious if you have benchmarked various HPA native thresholds for CPUs to compare the performance benefit or like the cost savings compared to predictive autoscaling versus more fine-tuned CPU threshold in HPA.
Yeah, so we haven't benchmarked for cost saving. I think the idea is like, yes, HPA can scale, but we just want to do it ahead of time. So some would say like, if we're scaling ahead of time, we're going to have a little bit of a couple pods earlier than we need. But the solution we're trying to tackle is have those pods ready to serve traffic. So I don't know if it's necessarily to save costs. It's more of like have pods ready to serve traffic.
Yeah, thank you. And another question, I'm curious if you looked into applying similar techniques to batch-like workloads, right-sizing jobs, pretty much.
Oh, like cron jobs?
Batch jobs.
Yeah, we haven't done that. That's part of our roadmap, but we are yet to do that, yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi. Thank you, Avni and Estela. This was a great presentation. I do see there's like very good qualitative benefit to this. So I personally have worked on right sizing as an app team, and we have struggled a bit. So this definitely gives qualitative benefit where we do not have to worry about and if there's a predictive model. One question I would have is, what's the quantitative benefit? So how many, do you have a reference? How many errors you reduced? What was the impact? Is there a quantitative benefit? And to add on to that, you said during certain time period in the week or during the day, the predictive model was lagging your actual. So did you figure out what percentage was that? And because that would actually affect your quantitative benefit. So thank you.
Yeah, so we do have this prediction metric running for several of our prediction services. We haven't benchmarked those. Currently, we're just fine-tuning our model and to see the best results, but we have yet to like benchmark those things.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great presentation. We've implemented something similar, even with the custom metric. Just for the same reasons, like some of our customers have predictive, needs instead of just reacting to load. One scenario we ran across was in some cases for very expensive workloads, they want to scale it down to zero, and HPA won't do that. Is there a did you guys end up trying some other thing like CADA, or was that a consideration?
Not for the solution, but we've looked into CADA just for that reason that we'd be interested in scaling down to zero pods. But like CADA is more of an event based autoscaling, right? And that's not really, we're more focused on CPU and memory for our apps.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So we have looked into it. It just doesn't really fit our
experience. All right. And one other question about scale. With larger the cluster, there's more metrics and other things to crank out. Have you guys run into kind of scale when you're trying to, because for each workload, you have to crank this out, right? Do you guys do it for selective workloads, or how did that work?
So can you repeat your question?
Yeah, so, you have to look at the prediction for each and every workload, right? Mm-hmm. The larger the cluster, the more workloads. Mm-hmm. So was this done for sort of like every workload, or was it like selected workloads? And because the scale is going to be an issue, right?
Yeah, so it'll look at all the pods in the cluster or for each service. So yeah, it's looking at all the workloads.
But like we've tested it on few of our services. Some services that are really critical. So we've tested against that, but we have to test it across the fleet.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks for the introduction. My question is, you just list a lot of models, and I want to know that which model is can better satisfy what kind of system?
Yeah, so we're interested in time forecasting models, right? So we just looked at some of the more popular models, and we already had a solution with the INHATES model, and we would just wanted to test against other models to see if we can see, find better performance. So currently our benchmark was just give it the same data and see which one produced the best results. And we did that iteratively, and so then we just stuck with the model that gave us the better results.
Okay, thank you. Another question is, if we only leverage 7 days historical data in advance, that move this metrics to the current place, or move the 7 days in advance data to current, and using this model, what's the more, why the model have more benefits for just compared with just using historical data to have this prediction?
Is your question about like giving more data?
I mean that, not giving more data. My question is to, you use a model has one choice. Another choice is use the historical data and move the historical data to the current time point. Why the model is more benefit than just to move the historical data to the current time point?
Okay, I don't really understand the question. We could talk after.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Thank you. I think for me it was most interesting sessions on KubeCon. And as you mentioned, you're a great open source contributor. So are you planning to open source these components?
Yeah, we really want to. We generally see interest in the community for these solutions. So we have it, whenever we are designing it, we have it in our head, but we haven't really open sourced it, but that's something that's on our radar.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks.
Yeah, I think first of all, thank you for the great event and then great presentation. My question is pretty straightforward, that for auto-scaling and very important for data scientists, machine learning perspective, and which is heavily in GPU, are we suitable for this one, the solution they provided for GPU resources?
We support GPU, but it's not widely used far. Gotcha.
And then can you briefly explain to me about the I see the promotes use metrics and then kind of communicating with machine learning model. What is the collection and what is the relationship between promotes and the machine learning model behind?
You mean this step?
Yeah, promotes and Grafana metrics are there, and then what is the relationship with the machine learning model for?
So the machine learning model will like generate a new metric, right? Mm-hmm. And we want to expose it to Prometheus. So then HPA could fetch that metric.
Oh, I see. Thanks.
Yeah. All right. Thank you, everyone.
Cool. Thank you.